Con nomás. Throwback Thursday. Woo. Welcome to hashtag PBT Throwback Thursday, music mix number 40 from the My PBT Network Studios, brought to you by the Law Office of Carlos A. Garcia. Órale. If you're injured in a serious accident, arrested on serious charges, si andas haciendo lo que no debes de ser, y pues de repente llegas a encarcelado, este es el número que tienes que llamar, 956-584-1448. It's 956-584-4048. If you need an attorney for some serious stuff, this is the guy to do it. He'll fight for you in court because serious cases require a serious lawyer. 24 hours a day, 24 horas al día, 7 días a la semana. Visit his website, thegarciafirm.com. He is board certified in criminal law by the Texas Board of Legal Specialization.
Wow.
Está pesado el chavo. Llega con guantes a la corte y ahí se quita los guantes. A tu pura mano pelón, vámonos recio. Sústame one time. He'll take care of you, folks. And once a month, we do the story behind the case. And that is some amazing stuff, man. The last one he told us was amazing. So look him up right here on our library of videos, ¿verdad? Make sure to like, subscribe, and share, okay? That is something. We're about 50 away from 17,000 subscribers and fastest growing YouTube channel in the United States of America. If you want to be part of the show, if you want to be part of the programming on hashtag PBT, text 956-641-3241. We have plenty of advertising possibilities for you. Y tú sabes, si se vienen con nosotros, le vamos a echar chingo de crema a los tacos, papá. So, ladies and gentlemen, we have some new t-shirts. Before we get to our guests, and I said guests with an S. We
plural.
Have,
plural.
Okay? Este, pues, si les gusta esta playera que dice, te lo cico, bro. Te lo cico. Which, by the way, I want to say hi to Reno in Del Rio, Texas.
Reno Luna, thank you.
Este, we have this shirt available. They're being made. They should be out by tomorrow. We should be mailing them out by Saturday or Monday. All right? You got to go. It's our Cash App. All right? And it's $ Rock and Roll James for the De Los Cinco license plate. All right? Just put LP. That is the code, LP. All right? So we know what shirt you want. And we have small through 4XL. Teníamos small through 2XL, pero no, hombre, puros gordos que están watchando el show, carnal.
Yeah.
Sústame, bien fluffy. No se les pasa ningún almuerzo, lonche o cena, nada de eso. Y snacks también, papá. So, LP is the Telocico shirt, okay? And we also have the Asústame One Time t-shirt. Órale, esa sí. Esa sí está bien caliente ahorita, pan caliente a madre. That's AOT. That is the code for that one. So if you send us the $35 on Cash App, put AOT if you want the Asustame One Time t-shirt, or LP if you want the Telocico license plate t-shirt, okay? And then put the size, small through 4XL, and then put your address, okay? Y si no cabe tu address, ponle tu cell phone. We'll contact you para ver para dónde tenemos que mandar la playera, la camisa. Yo digo camisa, pero mi wife siempre me hace correct con playera. Órale. She's the teacher. Shout out to my beautiful wife. How you doing, mama?
Hi, how are you?
Good. We've got some pretty interesting guests in
we
here
do.
Tonight, baby.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Without further ado, but before I start him out, I got to start. Let me see. Voy a comenzar con una rolita. ¿Verdad? A ver si se acuerda de esta rola. A ver,
I heard it earlier.
La estaba oyendo ahorita. A ver. Esta, a ver, vamos a ver.
Oh. Oh, come on, man.
No. Padrinos de música.
Oh.
Padrinos de cojín. Y ahora les presentamos la dama.
Dice la gente que somos muy jóvenes.
Está bien, papila.
Para saber.
Wow, I had not heard that song.
Wow. Ladies and gentlemen, Javier Galván is in the studio. Órale, sóstame one time.
Wow.
No llores, Javier. No llores. Quiere llorar. Israel. Israel, the keyboard is here with us too, man. Throw him a napkin or something, man. Está llorando Javier.
I have tissues.
Órale.
Let me use one of my asustamen más. One time.
Oy, oy.
Way back in the day.
Estabas bien chavalito aquí, ¿verdad?
Sé que me amas. Y sabes que te amo. Con eso va.
Where'd you get that?
This shit works better than Viagra, carnal. Se te viene todo el testosterone para atrás y la chica. Te pasas de puberty la chingada con esta rola, ¿no, carnal?
Bro, that's crazy. I don't even have that song.
Porque sufras más.
The beginnings of Javier Galván, dude. And fama.
Is that a 45?
Not the biggest production in the world, but it was the beginning of something that was going to get better, you know? Oh, yeah, I like this part. Y ahora les presentamos los padrinos de música, la familia Galván. Padrinos de cojín, la familia Rodríguez. How about this one, bro? Let's hear this one, bro.
Actually, that was a hit in my neighborhood.
Y esta la tocaban en todas las quinceañeras y las backyard parties. Yep. Y la
When the gig was going bad, we say, oh, let's hit him with this one.
Yeah. Oye, the intro's like 3 minutes long, dude. Yeah.
It's 2 minutes and 30 seconds.
The intro. Se pasan como 2 minutos y medio y después canta Javier la rola. Y se está nomás moviendo el side to side.
Sí, por el mullet. The cabaret cheese.
Yeah, the cabaret cheese. Remember that shit?
Remember that.
Oh, man. Oye, todavía no canta. Le metieron todos los botones del synthesizer. We're going to put all the different sounds of the synthesizer in the intro of the song, okay?
They were the new keyboards, so we had to use everything.
Yeah.
Hey, I was in the background. Now, boss, now.
Wow.
That's a 45, right? You got that off of 45?
Pues it's I got it off YouTube, bro.
Amor, amor, amor.
Yeah. Guardando en el corazón.
Guardado
en el corazón. And then let me see. Well,
at least I'm getting royalties.
Yeah. And then this one came up. And forget about it.
There you go.
You guys went all the way to the moon, right?
I have a story on that.
Yeah. Vamos a ir a.
Israel
and accordion.
Big stories. You know. Oh, man.
Va a llorar Israel. Va a llorar Israel.
You did it, man. You did it. You did it.
Va a llorar tu banda.
Gente quiere.
Oye, bro. Esta pinche rola la estaban tocando cada pinche hora en KXTN y en KIWW.
Where you were playing it.
Yeah.
But you know that. They played that song so much that when we were on the road, I would be like, otra vez.
Yeah. And then we got to play it tonight 3 times. And then we got to play the 20-minute version tonight. Right?
Hombre.
Y luego la piden otra vez.
Yeah. But, dude, it's like, that's like the song that Fama was like, it was the song that kind of put you guys on the map, no?
You know, that song was not going to be recorded. We had 9 songs, and my brother loved Los Humildes.
Yeah.
And you know, they're good, but my brother really loved Los Humildes. And we needed one more song. We were at Amen Studios with Manny Guerra, and all the guys were there, and we had come back from dinner, and we needed that one song. And my brother says, we couldn't decide. My brother says, let's just record Ojitos Color Café. I was like, no, let's just record my song. Everything I wrote, you know?
Yeah.
And so finally, I got outvoted. We recorded that song, Jesús, from Orale Primo, Jesús Sotero.
Okay.
From Orale Primo, took the single from Sony, Fama single, to Monterrey, and it became a big old hit in Monterrey, and then it hit over here.
Wow.
And so when we went to Monterrey, our first gig in Monterrey, La Expo de Guadalupe, we had we were in front of 82,000 people.
Yeah.
And it was incredible. That's they knew this song, Te Voy a Enseñar, and all the other, it was like incredible.
Well, chills, bro.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Chills, dude.
Yeah.
And it's crazy because this song, when I hear it, it kind of reminds me of that part of Tejano where it like went into the general the regional, market.
Yeah, regional Mexico.
It went from just like, you know, local stuff. It went, and it was the 90s. It was like, yeah. What year was this song out?
This was 92.
92. And 92. That's basically around that time. 90 is cuando entraron todos los BMI, Capitol, Sony. You guys got Fonovisa. Picked up Fonovisa. Yep. You guys got picked up by Sony, right?
Yep. We were with Sony for 12 years.
Now, when you guys started the band, Israel was with you. Yep. Y'all know each other from Houston or what? Y'all from the Houston area, right?
Yep.
Pero tú estabas diciendo que naciste aquí en Díaz Ordaz y tu carnal en La Joya, Texas.
Yeah.
My
mom couldn't cross the border with that big old belly.
Es el que chalán está muy pesado para chalán tú, carnal. Lady, because there's a chalán here in Los Ébanos that crosses. It's like the only
hand-pulled ferry
in the United States of America. And it goes to Mexico, Díaz Ordaz.
Is it still there?
It's still there, bro. Wow. It's like something that's really like historic. It's history. So you were born, what year were you born there?
I was born in 1980.
What?
I was born in October 28th.
October 28th, 1969.
I was born in Díaz Ordaz, and at four years old, we moved to Mission. We did it the right way. Mm-hmm. We got arreglamos. We came to Mission ahí en La Cuchilla. Uh-huh. We used to live right there.
I know La Cuchilla, bro. Yeah.
We lived there for 2 years, and then we moved to Houston. And then in Houston, we grew up.
You're from La Cuchilla in Mission, bro? Cuchilla. That is crazy,
We used to steal the toronjas y las naranjas.
Man. Wow, man. That's crazy. It was all citrus down here back in that time, man.
Yep.
And so what year was it that you all moved to Houston?
We moved here in 74 and then to Houston in 76.
Uh-huh.
So we moved out there and we made our life there in El Dorado and Denver Harbor area. Started the band. I was 15 years old when we started the band.
¿Y tu jefito se fue para allá con tu jefita y toda la familia? Porque agarró jale allá tu jefe.
He was working on it. He was a welder.
Welder?
Yeah.
¿Y estás hablando en las refineries y todo eso?
No, he was working for F.H. Maloney and Brown & Root.
Órale.
Y ganaba buena feria, and we had a good life.
Sí. Pues los welders hacen buena feria, ¿verdad, Israel?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they did good.
Yeah. Y ustedes dijeron, no, yo voy a ser músico, Dad. Yeah. What the hell?
I break out. I see a hammer. I go, I don't go to Home Depot.
I was just telling when I used to help my dad do mechanics. Me, a ver, tráeme el 916, si la chingada. Pues, ¿a cuál es? Yo no sé qué chingada está ahí. Y ahí iba y se la daba. ¡Esta no es! And then, like, my dad had, like, a generalization, a word that just...
A
universal word for every tool in the toolbox. It was chingadera. Hey, tráeme esa chingadera que está allá. Yeah, man. So your dad was a welder, man. That's great. And your mom was a homemaker.
Yep.
¿Y tú, Israel? ¿Tu jefito?
He was a carpenter.
¿Tú naciste ahí en Houston? ¿Dónde?
En Yoakum.
Yoakum, Texas. ¿Dónde mero está eso?
About like maybe an hour from Victoria.
Órale.
30, 40
north?
Yeah, north.
Entre medio de Houston y Victoria.
Mm-hmm. It's Kennedy and Hearn, Texas. Hearn, so what is it? Hearn?
Nombre Wharton. Like Wharton.
Wharton on that TP Hotel.
Yeah.
They have like TP.
Oh, yeah, the guy that won the lotto, right?
The TP Motel?
Way before then. But I was out there, and then we moved to, we moved to El Campo and then to Houston.
Uh-huh.
And from there, shit, it's real kind of funny because I didn't want to be a musician, you know?
No.
And then my dad, he played bass. And then I could remember, man, like all my cousins outside playing, and I was over there locked up in the room. So, no, you're going to learn how to play. I was like, okay.
Yeah.
And it stayed with me. And
I
was... Not to be like that, but I don't know, for some reason, it just seemed natural.
See?
And I would remember practicing, like, organ parts for Agustin and
some
Freddy,
people
you
just,
know?
Like, they just, like, they catch it, and they, like, pick nothing to them, bro.
Yeah.
They got that natural ability, bro.
Yeah.
And so what year were you born, Israel?
69.
¿Están iguales ustedes mismos?
He's older.
He's older a couple of months, okay.
Yeah, he's older.
I think it was meant to be, man, because we're, like, everything's, like, real close for me and him. And when I met this guy, I was like... I was playing with all the locals, but I met him, and I was like, man, this guy's voice, man.
Mm-hmm.
He's killer.
Oh, stop it.
And I was like, dude, let's go. But I didn't tell him. And I was like, you know.
And in the first album, le echamos mucha crema a los tacos del vato, yo creo.
I was excited, bro.
if you would have seen him, like, when I first went over there, I was like, man, this dude, like, I don't know. It was just like natural.
Yeah.
Because you don't even mess up.
No.
There was a chemistry. Yeah. There was an awesome chemistry. Oscar, my older brother, the bass player.
Uh-huh.
Man, the way he played simple, but played, I mean, right on there. I mean, it sounded like a first drop.
Like, uh-huh. The first day I showed up with them, it was like, and I always said this because I always liked La Sombra and all these little groups that were coming up. But they're not little. They're big groups. But I was like, man, I want to be like them. And a mafia and all that. And then when I got with these guys, I went to practice. I was like, this is it. Here's the band right here.
Yeah.
And I just left it alone and good Lord took it over, man.
It's interesting when you hear a vocalist and you know, I mean, this guy's got some pipes. He's got some style and all that. I mean, for a long time, I was there's a story I have about when I first heard Joe Lopez sing like off the stage, in like a private party. We're just hanging out. It was him and Jimmy's birthday. And it was at the Border Apartments in Brownsville, and I showed up, and then Joe shows up, right? And you know, I was like in the heavy metal, and I heard the records and all that, and then there were some mariachis, and then he just belts out like a few words, a few sentences with the mariachis, and I was like, "Alalba, vato."
He sang good,
you know? Yeah, and so that's probably what you felt when you heard this guy singing, man.
Yeah,
you know, you start hearing that, man. Y de ahí pues, amor, 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 man. ¿Qué año salió ese? Salió como 90, 88, 89, ¿no?
We recorded that in 1990. Hijo de su.
Were you all like together before that in the mid-80s? When did the band first form?
I never played so many quinceañeras.
We were the quinceañera band.
Esas pagan a toda madre.
I was with other bands at that time. And when I was with other bands. When I got with them, I was tired of doing that. But the money was, it was there constantly. Like every weekend for like 2-3 years.
Yeah, every week.
I thought I was with a big band already.
Yeah.
And so then when we were Sony, it was like, oh man, this is like, it was.
The band started July 15th of 1985.
Were you all doing covers and stuff?
Yeah, we were doing Mas, we were doing La Mafia, we were doing Little Joe. What's that?
What's that? What is real? Like giving me a head sign.
He was Ram. He was Ram. Kind of Emilio.
Was you sing Ram? You remedas a Ram, verdad?
No.
No.
Era George Strait y todo.
We sang a little bit of everything, man.
Sí. A ver, a ver. Amor. Querido.
Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah.
We were playing all the hits.
Hey, he even went as far as guitar and Cadillacs. I think that's the way
he
said it.
Oh, remember that?
Guitar and Cadillacs. Yeah. I was like, this guy.
That's quinceañera music.
Y ahora le cantamos a la quinceañera una bonita selección con Grupo Fama. Están cantando una canción de Ram the Man Herrera. Y aquí les va Javier Galván. Cantando Ram.
I don't remember the words.
Despertaré.
Here we go.
Que la luz del día y la mañana.
No, cámala, cámala, cámala. Vamos, lo comenzamos otra vez, carnal. No hay pedo. Put your hands together, man, ladies and gentlemen.
Aquí va.
Ahorita te mandan un super chat, carnal, unos $10 ahí de vuelta. Por el super chat. Aquí, aquí.
Deja que mi pecho sea tu almohada al despertar.
Boy.
Vamos a ir a Walmart HEB después de cargas.
Vamos a bailar, baby.
You know, here's my thing. If I forget the words, uh-huh. I just make it rhyme and nobody even knows.
Nadie sabe, carnal. Ya andan pedos todos.
That's right.
Y ahí, tú necesitas un teleprompter o como dicen. Estás peor que Joe Biden para leer las words, carnal.
No, bro. Last night we did the Johnny Canales show.
Oh, yeah.
And I had my iPad there with my own songs.
No, bro.
I wrote the songs for my wife. And so anyhow, but it's all good.
Yeah. So y'all were doing covers, man. ¿Y por qué me dijiste así, bro? ¿Qué me ibas a decir?
Because I knew he wasn't going to tell you. He was like, no, I'm going to get him right here.
Que no me iba a decir Ram Herrera.
We did Emilio. We did Ram. We did.
Yeah, I love Ram.
Bunch of. No, it's not. I love the guys too, but man, that would freak me out too. But I loved it because I thought it was like, oh, big band, man, we're jamming.
But you know, we're friends with everybody. I mean, all the musicians, and you know, you hear that, hey, que este, man, I love everybody, man. All my musician friends.
Pero en aquellos días había chingo de competition, carnal, la mafia y más y todos andaban en.
Yeah.
era warfare. Yeah. Amare. I'm not going to open up for them.
Yeah, they're not going to open up for me. ¿Sabes lo que dijo Roberto Pulido? I'll open up. The sooner I play, the sooner I go party.
While you all were fighting, Roberto was living the life.
Yeah, that's right.
Y de ahí te ponías de opening act y te chingaban todo el sonido y la chingada, ¿no?
We had that a lot of times. Yeah. But anyhow.
No jalan los monitors, no jalan los monitors. Ahora sí no jalan los pinches monitors. Órale, súbele, carnal, ándale. A ver, ahora sí, yeah. Te está rechinando todo. Yeah. Bien gachos, yeah. Bro. They didn't want the bands to look good.
Yeah, that was bad. That happened a lot. I remember one time we were at the Selena Auditorium, uh-huh. And we were playing. It was Querer Tu Amor that had just hit.
Uh-huh.
And as we were playing Querer Tu Amor, all the people were, you know, it was a hit. Uh-huh. So people went, you know, they cheered, they clapped, and they were screaming. And the sound kept going lower and lower and lower and lower. It's like, what's going on here?
Oh, man, bro. So. I mean, we're at the mercy. Once we get on stage, we're at the mercy. But right. but you know, you got to go through that when you're growing and making music. That's how you learn how to, you know, control other things. You know, no, I'm going to say. Was there any band that you all had any rivalry with when you were starting up?
It was La Sombra and La Mafia.
See?
Yeah. And La Fiebre.
But why?
Yeah, not so much. But
La Sombra was from Chicago, right?
Yeah, the Windy City.
But the rest of the guys, La Mafia, were from Houston, La Fiebre, Pasadena. You guys are considered Houston as well, right?
Right.
Y había chingo de animosity ahí con ustedes ahí.
There was, and then when the people would say, oh, you know, if somebody would say something, they'd egg you on. Uh-huh. So te daba más coraje, you know?
Yeah.
But you know what? We're great friends with them. Yeah. Now we're great friends. I prayed with Tony Guerrero when he was going through his
arrímate
thing.
Un poquito más al micrófono, yeah.
And we got to pray with him when he was in the hospital. He was in the hospital for a few months.
Sí, aquí tuvo el Monday.
Oh, really?
He was here Monday.
Yeah,
night,
how's
bro.
He doing? I haven't spoken with him.
He's doing good, man. Pero pues sí, well, I mean, he really wants to get out there and play again. You know,
yeah.
I mean, that stuff is what happens. Is like when you're like not doing the things you love to do. Your immune system weakens.
Yeah, man, you get depressed.
And you know, cuando estás haciendo lo que te gusta hacer y te da felicidad, el immune system, el cuerpo, it rejuvenates, you know?
Yeah.
And so, you know, I mean, once the band start getting up and start playing and start, you know, doing what they love to do is receiving the energy from the audience, everybody's going to get a lot more healthier, man.
Absolutely,
nowadays, man,
absolutely.
You know?
And I think that's why a lot of musicians last a long time, you know? Mm-hmm. And, most of them.
The ones that get off the sauce in time.
El que no se dieron el doble, dice, pero. But you know, the thing is that when you do what you love to do, it's an amazing thing, man. You know, you can be depressed, but once you get on that stage, mm-hmm. Oh my God, something changes.
Yeah, it's a no pain zone.
Está como el tatamuro, you know, and then when he gets on the stage, amor, amor, you know. Hey, no stuttering there, you know.
Mel Tillis, ¿te acuerdas el Mel Tillis, bro?
Mel Tillis, yeah.
It's like I was telling Guajardo a little bit ago, man, my wife and I mean, we can be like dog tired at 7:30 and we'll drag our butts and we'll get behind the microphone here. And then as soon as the show starts, it's like being on stage. We get the same feeling because of the energy from the chat, people on the chat zone, you know?
Yeah.
So this has become an alternative for us to be able to do what we love to do. And what I like about this show, that I'm able to, you know, utilize all my creativity, you know, when in other aspects of my career, you have to follow a certain protocol, you know?
Yeah.
But in this case, you know, si quiero poner fama y de poner Metallica, pues...
And you know what? At the end of it, everything falls in place.
See,
everything fits in perfect.
Yeah, man. And then I realized that this is a great platform to reach to people, you know, reach
absolutely.
Out to people.
Especially
you know?
Right now, bro.
Yeah, man. And you know what? The best thing that they've told us is like, man, dude, after... you see this on the chat zone. After a shitty day... it's great to be able to come home and get some happiness with this show, you know? And I said, you know what? That is what it's all about, you know? Yeah. And that's what music is all about as well. And that's what you guys have been doing for a long time, man.
You know, I realized that with music, it changes people's moods. It changes people's lives, you know? I realized that with the song Hoy Vi Orar a Santa Claus. Mm-hmm. We recorded that song. And when we saw grown men calling the radio station pero gente de Honduras, de Salvador, de, you know, people around us at the Tejano industry, but all, I mean, from all walks of life. Mm-hmm. And when that song came out during the Christmas holidays, and, you know, the song talks about a dad who's going through a separation and the daughter goes to Santa Claus and says, I don't want nothing for me. I want something for my mom. I want my daddy to come back. When we released that song, I realized that I could make a difference in people's lives by writing, you know, and make money.
Yeah.
Well, you know, make royalties.
Well, you have to. You know, yeah. I mean, there has to be, you know, some sort of financial reward to what you do in order to keep doing it. Yeah. You know, people, a lot of people don't understand. That's why, you know, we, you know, you have to sell, we have to sell our music. We have to sell our shirts. We have to, so it helps us out, and it, you know, we can further and keep doing what we're doing, and that's what musicians would do, man. When during the when Amor, what label was that on the
Sony?
First
album?
Sony.
It was always Sony.
So you guys got picked up by Sony, huh?
Right, 1989. Well,
that was like an overnight.
Rosario,
thing, man.
No, Ray Martinez.
Ray Martinez.
Ray Martinez went to Houston. Mm-hmm. Picked us. He checked us out. Then that was on a Wednesday, and then on Friday he called us that he was gonna draw up a contract if we were interested, and so the next few weeks we negotiated and signed the contract.
Yeah, ¿y qué tomó? ¿Cómo tuvo el contract?
That was a horrible
chingo de música, chingo de feria.
No, I tell you what, it was no, it was
compraron Cadillacs y la chingada.
No, the first contract was not a financial gain, you know,
Pinto.
But we were with Sony, so on the third album, which was where Ojitos Color Café came out, that's when it hit. They wanted to renegotiate our contract because we had a 3-year with two-year options, so it was a 5-year contract.
So cuando hicieron el first contract, que les pasaron una feria para que grabaran, o nomás les dieron el estudio y les dieron el producto y ustedes.
They just paid for the production.
And the songs on Amor, 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 are they compositions? Your compositions?
Most of them, yeah.
And so you were able to publish them, and
yeah.
Because that's what happens with a lot of songwriters. No, they don't publish their own music. Right. Y salen, you know, robados de los labels and the publishing companies.
Well,
man,
the
¿verdad?
Publishing company was Sony. Then once we renegotiated our contract on the third one, then I renegotiated my publishing. So we started Famous Music Publishing, which is my publishing now. Mm-hmm. And I tell you what, man, that was the greatest move because once the internet hit, we didn't get paid for a long time for internet. But then when we did, it retroed the amounts all the way back to 1989.
Yeah.
So it's been
incredible. ¿Y te cayó un chequecito bruto? ¿Qué tanto fue? De, ¿No puedes decir?
It was good.
O sea, el IRS no watch el show, carnal.
Oh, no, I paid the IRS. Bro, I paid the IRS, yeah, trust me.
I know, bro. You have to, bro.
It was my first bill.
Yeah, musicians, they fall into that hole with the IRS,
No, 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 no.
Watch out Willie Nelson, carnal.
Yeah, but Willie the people Nelson? Helped him.
Yeah, no, pero como quiera, 50 million o algo así, está entrado el vato. Hey, I was just smoking my duber. Somebody was supposed to be paying that shit. I don't know. Y hasta le quitaron la guitarra con bujero y la chingada al pobre vato.
Lucio, ¿cómo se llamaba la guitarra?
I don't know that. Nada.
Esa era de BB.
BB King.
BB King.
Yeah, man. So then the Sony, the first album, because you can tell the difference in production, bro.
Yeah, I always say that. Like, you, man, you know right off.
Yeah.
And you know, that was the thing with them. Have you remember we were in the little garage practicing? And,
a lot of times.
Ray Martinez got there. Can I say that name?
Ray Martinez.
Okay. And he says, hey, man, that was a guy from Sony. I was like, dude, you kidding me, man? Like, are you serious? And he got to talking, and I was like, man, in my mind, I was like, wow.
No more quinceañera.
Yeah, that's it. It's over with. And from
thank
there,
you, Jesus.
You know what? With this band, and I think that's why a lot of people wonders why about that label and all that. Man, it was like an overnight thing. Like, it really was. Mm-hmm. In that 1 week, I think that was on a Tuesday. And 1 week, the next following week, they were already telling me, hey, we're this and this and this in the studio. And this
yeah,
and, I was like, what?
Yeah.
I was like, there's no way, man.
The logistics,
these guys
everything.
Don't do that.
Yeah.
It happened quick.
It was, I mean, it took off, man.
Yeah. It took time to get there, but when you got there, it was off to the races.
Oh, man, it was crazy. And we got there right when Tejano began to explode.
Yeah.
You know, La Sombra, La Fiebre.
Everybody.
La Mafia, Mas, I mean, Ram Herrera, Emilio Navaira, everybody, Selena, everybody was just boom, 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 hit after hit. It just went everywhere.
Yeah. Everywhere. But it's like I was telling Israel, you know, you can tell the difference in the albums. It's like, you know, there's a different cook now. You know what I mean? At the restaurant, you go and anyway, the food's the taste different. Same thing when you listen, like Gary Hobbs had Las Miradas, that album, stock one madre production, show you el punchy la chinga. Then the next one sounds a little less like that. And then the next one sounds even less. In that,
right.
And same thing with Ram Herrera. Remember the Pensamientos, I think is the name of that album that has man, Amor y Besos, and all that. Con Joel Guzman, bro. I mean, it's a pinche album, tiene un production bruto, bro. Te pega de volada.
And you know, you just said it, it's the producer that actually creates the atmosphere and creates his whatever his background is, he's putting it all on the line. And ours was Luis Silva, because the first two albums we produced them ourselves. And the third album, it was Luis Silva. Uh-huh. And that was where Ojitos Color Café.
And it just took,
it was a Como Nunca, the Como Nunca album.
Yeah,
Como Nunca. It just took
and
off.
That's totally
it,
the truth.
Even the packaging was great. The picture was awesome. You know, like on this one of Amor, Amor, you all are just standing in line.
And it's a fake
background. Was, but that Como Nunca, you know, there was some sort of, there was an idea to it. It was a concept to it, man.
Yep. And it just took off. We started doing Don Francisco. We started doing Ocurre Así. They did a big old special on us. Control. We did Padrísimo. We started Onda doing Max. All the tele Onda Max. All the big international television shows. And it was incredible.
I think the reason that went, you know, was Javier's voice. It has an international flavor. You know. Yeah. When I would listen to your singing and your music, it sounded different than the Tejano. I always thought this guy can probably sing some international stuff and it'll work, you know? And so you were getting into all those big shows, man. That's awesome, man.
Yeah, we got to play with a lot of big artists, man. I mean, you know, not, ni se diga, Ramon, of course, Ramon Ayala, Los Tigres del Norte,
Bronco,
Gloria Estefan, who was that? John Secada. You know, international artists that I would have never imagined that. I mean, a little group from Houston, El Dorado, you know, the little neighborhood, Denver Harbor. And, man, God had a plan. I tell you what, man, it's amazing to sit here and reminisce and talk about those days, because I would have never imagined that I would have this conversation and looking back and seeing how much success we've had.
And the song that we just played at the very beginning, no, Dice La Gente. I knew I was in the shower listening to the playlist and I was like, man, I'm going to play that first, bro. I'm going to play that first. And I told my wife, oh, man, there's a song that I heard. And I bet you that he hasn't heard in a long time, Javier, you know, and so I threw it on, and the look on your face was priceless, bro. I hope
I
you got it, babe.
I did.
And then he wanted to cry, right? And then I played the next song, and Israel wanted to cry over there.
Why are you crying?
Yeah, dude. What feelings do you get when you hear that song, when you heard that song? What was the feeling you got, bro?
Well, me, it takes me back, because I remember rehearsing in that garage at Mr. Romo's house, and it just takes me back to those memories, you know.
Loco,
and it's like smelling a certain perfume, like La Variantina. Uh-huh. It reminds me of my grandpa, you know. There's certain smells. Yeah. When I hear a certain song, it takes me back to Astro World. It takes me back to the Astrodome. It takes me back to, you know, the places where it was where it was created, you know.
Yeah,
so I went back to 1985.
Yeah. Israel, man, what about you, bro? What did you feel when you heard those songs?
The memory I get from there is just from taking off, like, from that point, I know, hey, here we go. Like, for me, there's not even a story, because, man, I knew already. I knew in my mind. I was like, here it goes. This is it right here. Boom. Ojitos, te voy a enseñar. Even with I knew it already. I said, man, here we go. We're gone.
Yeah.
I knew it.
Te voy a enseñar, bro. That song had a big international flavor when it came out. And let me put it on, man, because I love that song, bro. And just the whole boom, boom.
And I remember when
it sounded big, bro, right?
Yep. Yeah, that was awesome.
What were you saying?
Well, as far as Te Voy a Enseñar, I remember when he had told me, he said, check out the song. And
we were in Mexico.
Man, it was just like a click, dude. It was just boom. Like, even now, I'm not going to lie to you, about, what, Javi, 2 weeks ago, 3 weeks ago? The cumbia?
Oh, yeah, that was about a month ago. Yeah.
Check out this cumbia real quick. Dude, like in 8 minutes.
Yeah, we got into the studio.
I was like, what? I said, the magic is still there, man. Yeah.
It's a isn't chemistry. That incredible, I remember bro? When I wrote Te Voy a Enseñar, we were in Guadalajara. We were doing a promotional tour, and we had played several events. And so, yeah, there you go. And I got on the plane, and I didn't have anything to write with or write on. And I asked the flight attendant if she had a pen and a paper. She said, I have a pen, but you can get the paper from that little bag, you know, that barf bag. And I tore it open, and I started writing this song.
Bien internacional, what do you think when you recorded this? Is like, who produced this one? Luis Silva?
Yeah, it was on the album where we produced it with that Luis Silva produced. Now that was our very first music video. We had never done a music video. We saw MTV and
not
all
even
the
for Ojitos Color Café.
No.
I wondered about that. I had never seen a video of you guys doing that.
No. Te Voy a Enseñar was our very first music video, and we filmed it there in Houston. And, man, it became a huge... I tell you what, when we played in front of those 82,000 people for the first time at the Expo, the people were singing this song so loud that it hurt our ears. Remember that?
I couldn't hear none of them. Wow. I was doing the lead, and I was like, I don't even know if I'm doing it. I knew from visual, but I couldn't hear the bam, 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 bam. I couldn't hear nothing. I couldn't hear anything at all, man.
Yeah.
Wow.
It was so loud.
That's awesome, bro.
We got off the stage, bro. They pulled our hair, the fans, and Servando Cano, déjalos, déjalos. The security was trying to stop. No, déjalos, déjalos. Yeah. They were taking pictures. Hey, they're pulling my hair, bro.
Yeah.
We get to the hotel. We have security at the elevator and all kinds of stuff. We're like, wow, I think we've arrived.
In Mexico, bro?
In Mexico, in Monterrey.
What was the most southern you went to play, man, back in the day?
I think all the way down to Oaxaca.
Somewhere, yeah.
We went all the way down to as far as you can go. Mm-hmm. But
in Mexico?
In Mexico.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Did you go anywhere further south, you know, like Colombia and all those other areas?
No, we did a...
Was it Guadalajara?
Guadalajara is still Mexico, yeah. But
yeah, Guatemala?
I don't know. Javier knows more than I do on that.
I went to Brazil to go film for Tejano Country. Remember Tejano Country?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember that.
We went out there and we did a giveaway and all that.
Brazil.
Brazil.
Monty.
Yeah.
Rio de Janeiro. Monty, ¿verdad?
Yeah, Monty.
Monty Lewis.
Monty Lewis, yeah. Monty
Lewis. Fue Brazil contigo.
Yeah.
Wow, man. And I wonder what happened to Monty Lewis.
He's
bro.
In Europe.
What the hell is he doing in Europe? Hey, Monty, what's going on?
Yeah, he's in Europe. Yeah. He's doing amazing out there.
Frank De Leon he's with another radio station here. He's one of the guys who gave me my first DJ gig at a club. He was a host of that show, but Monty Lewis ended up taking most of the shows. And I remember going to San Antonio because we had Puro Tejano and it was Tejano Country. And, La Fiebre, right. Mafia and Fama, we were rivals, you know. But I was never felt any rivalry with anybody because to me, hey, may the best man win, you know. I mean, it doesn't matter to me, you know. And I got to San Antonio and we ran into each other and we ended up hanging out all night, man. We had a great time. Monty se portó toda madre, bro. And it was a really nice time that we hung out. But you went to Brazil with him, and what did you do over there?
We filmed some videos, and then we filmed, it wasn't music videos, it was just for the Tejano Country.
Oh, okay.
And we did some little short, like mini-series things, but they never did anything.
I wonder if it's on YouTube, bro. There's a lot of Puro Tejano stuff
bro,
on YouTube.
I've looked, Puro Tejano, but not Tejano Country because of, they had some legality things going on. I did a television show called, what was it called? Dímelo. On Galavision, and they were produced by the TC Network. Yeah. I did that for 2.5 years, and that's how I got to San Antonio.
You were hosting it, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I remember that, bro. Yeah,
with Anabel Ayarto and Luis Munoz was a producer. And
¿dónde estabas grabando ese programa?
They're in San Antonio in a warehouse right off of Desavala.
Órale. Yeah,
it was really nice. They did an awesome job on the set and all that.
Yeah. But now, bro, you don't need $50,000 cameras.
No.
You don't need a big $1 million.
Do it with your phone, man.
Wrestling toys atrás de mí.
Yeah.
You know, and a lot of this stuff is sent to us by fans, bro.
Wow, that's amazing.
They send us stuff to put on the back of the, you know, and this shirt was sent by a fan. Yes.
Really?
You know, and, you know, but. Man, I tell you what, bro, it's different nowadays.
I think the fans want to see this better because it seems like, as for me, like, whenever I watch programs like that, like, you're actually there with them. It just seems more I don't know, like homie, like, you know what I'm saying? Like
personal?
Yeah, personal. You get to see them.
It's real.
Yeah, it's not like that show thing where you see all the lights.
It's not scripted.
Right, right.
I get, you know what, man, dude, I hate to say it, but I, you know, I'm in the morning, I'm watching, and then they have the TV on in the lounge, and they have it on some morning programs like Good Morning America, all those.
Right.
And I can't help but think those people are fake to me. You know what I mean? They're fake.
That's
dude.
What
I mean,
feel.
It's like they're a whole totally different person when once the camera's
well, because
off.
They have somebody to answer to, and they have an agenda, you know? And so it's,
what do you
it's
think different. About the, you know, the whole atmosphere going on in the United States right now, bro?
I think it's a crazy world, bro. I never thought, first of all, the pandemic. But, you know, there's a scripture in the Bible, and it says that when Joseph and his brothers and all that, but it says that what the enemy meant for evil, God turned to good. And I truly believe in my life and in our ministry and in the music, and this is why we're here, because of this pandemic. It took a turn so that I would get out of retirement.
Mm-hmm.
And so our ministry grew. We opened up a farmer's market, my wife and I and some friends of ours, Richard and Lynn Cruz. We opened up a farmer's market 2 weeks before the pandemic hit. We had no idea what was happening. So we opened up this farmer's market, and all of a sudden, 2 weeks later, we closed. I mean, it was incredible. Yeah. But then we were at Trader's Village, and everyone was closed, including ourselves. And then they approached us from Trader's Village and said, can you open up so you can distribute, you know, some boxes and all that. So we started helping people with food. And you know how crazy it was. No toilet paper, no food. Dude, I mean, it was crazy.
I know. El toilet paper lo compraron de volada,
So anyhow, we started to distribute what we called the Heroes Boxes, and they were full of produce and fruits and vegetables. And we started to distribute thousands and thousands of boxes of produce to the people, and we started helping people. Our ministry grew. Right now we have some veteran homes that where we're getting homeless veterans off the street because of COVID. We began to get with different organizations. We're placing veterans that were homeless in these homes.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're doing now with our ministry, you know, and it's just incredible. Now, during COVID, maybe I'm jumping ahead of myself, but we found out that, you remember when I gave Fama away, right?
Mm-hmm.
I gave the band to some of the band members, and they...
Yeah, because you own the name, right, or something right, like that?
Fama Enterprises, Inc. I gave Fama Enterprises, Inc. to the guys, and this is the first time I ever talk about it on the air, mm-hmm. and I gave it to them.
Your brothers?
No, my brothers were with me. My brothers had quit.
Okay.
Oscar and Edgar had already...
So who did you give the name to?
To Eddie and John.
Eddie and John, which were... What did they...
The drummer and the guitar player.
Okay, the drummer and the guitar player. And did they want it? Were they asking for it?
Well, I decided to retire, so I didn't think it was fair for them to retire with me, you know? So mm-hmm. I gave them the band, and they never switched the name over. They never took ownership, you know, legally.
Well, before you get any further, that was very admirable of you to do that for your friends or for your musician buddies, man. That was awesome, bro.
Well, I just thought that it wouldn't be fair for them because I was ready to retire. Mm-hmm. I really was. I wanted to serve God in my 110% capacity, and I began to travel to Mexico, to Peru, to different parts of the world as a missionary, as a minister. And I got ordained as a minister, as a pastor. Mm-hmm. We were doing a lot of different ministry events. And, I mean, we did well, bro. I mean, I'm telling you, what we did with Fama, we were doing in ministry. As far as success, mm-hmm. you know, monetarily, the same. I mean, God has taken care of us.
Yeah.
But then COVID hit.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
Go ahead.
No, well, I wanted to go back to the guys not signing the name of Fama Enterprises over to themselves, right? What happened there?
I really don't know what was in their mind, but I found out during COVID, my attorney called me and, well, my CPA, and said, hey, listen, the Fama Enterprises, Inc. is in default. It's been in default for 10 years, and it's still under your name. I said, what? Under my name? He said, yes. So they sent me the actual screenshot of it, and I was like, oh, my gosh. And I got sued over the name, you know? And so I go back and we contact each other, and I really can't say a whole lot of the details, but I can tell you this, that we took care of that problem with the Fama Enterprises, Inc. They never assumed the name from Fama Enterprises, Inc. Fama Enterprises, Inc. is a corporation.
Uh-huh.
And so they had never, they never took that. It's like me giving you a house and you build a house next door and never live in this one.
Uh-huh.
You know, so it's still mine. It's still under my name. I'm still liable for whatever penalties they are. So what we did, we
got that right, made it right. And then we started Javier, what's that?
We're back.
Yeah. So now we're Javier Galván y su grupo Fama, okay. LLC.
And what happened to the guitar player and the drummer?
They're doing their own thing.
Okay.
And
was it amicable that, you know, you guys got the name back since they never signed off on it or anything?
I don't think it is. We haven't really spoken. I let them know what was going on, and I got a text saying that we never assumed the name, they never assumed the name.
And they weren't doing anything with the name, and they weren't performing under the name Fama, or were
they? Oh, yeah, they were, but because of COVID, they weren't.
Oh.
But here's the deal. Other things that happened, like there were gigs that were happening on their side,
mm-hmm.
And they would people would think that I was going to show up because it was.
Well, you're the face. The vocalist.
You know, I was doing gigs with my cousin because he was the one that was the name that was given to, and it was him and John.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead and lift the mic up, yeah, man.
And they said,
you're gonna have to slouch down, bro.
So then. He, you know, John decides to get out, and he don't want nothing to do with it. Uh-huh. But not out of music. He just didn't want nothing to do with the name. And so I had nowhere to really go. I'm a painter, man. So I paint in Houston, and I do my own thing because I'm not going to starve to death.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, he's not doing nothing. And I mean, he's doing his own thing. And I'm like, so all these years go by, and I start to find out about all this. And I would do gigs with him. And then.
With Javier?
Yeah, no, with my cousin. And some people would come up to me and say, when is Javier getting here? I was like...
Oh, so you were doing gigs
with his cousin.
With his cousin.
No, okay. I still wasn't with Javier yet.
Okay, because I'm a little confused here. You gave the name to the guitar player and drummer.
Right.
They never signed on to it. They were playing with the name.
With the name.
Were you playing with them?
Yes.
Well, yeah, because my cousin calls me and goes, hey, cuz, since Javier's not here anymore, you're interested in playing with us? I said, no, I don't want to do nothing no more. Like, I don't want to do nothing more.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, come on, just help us out. So I start helping him out. And then as we're going, like, I would get people come up to me because... To me, in my eyes, really seriously, that voice, and not to be big and macho, but man, you know, these hands, well, they belong to God, but they're made for Fama, man. I mean, me and him are just like,
was happening. People were being told that I was going to show up to quinceañeras and weddings and things like that.
And they were getting deposits, man, right. For that.
And so, and I think that's what you're...
That's basically what it is. And then I would be like, well, he's...
Yeah.
This guy's not showing up. I mean, I'm here.
Man,
dude, I'm an original, but he's not showing. And they'd be like, what? And I'd be like, man, I don't want no part of this, man.
Yeah. Oh, man. So they were being insincere, and they were being a little devious then, with, you know, by saying, you know, kind of promising Javier for the show, and he wasn't going to show up. And then he wouldn't show up. And what would they do? I'm sure they'd have to.
Well, we have letters and affidavits from people that actually, because people would call me and cuss me out, bro. And I'm running a ministry, and you son of a quinceañera.
¿Dónde chingados estás? Mi hija se quedó en la quinceañera sola.
Hey, bro, bro, I can't tell you how many times people call, and I'd be like, what? They think I'm going to be there. But I didn't think, you know, that they were just saying this to people. But it turns out with the letters and affidavits that we have that they were being told that I would be there. And so... So I said, that's not right. I mean, not for me, bro. You know what? I'm okay. I'm a big boy. But
that's disingenuous, bro.
That's fraud, man.
Yeah, it's
and
fraud,
people,
bro.
And they're breaking people's hearts.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, it's like, no, man, that's not right. You can't do that. Promoters would call me, hey, bro, ¿dónde andabas anoche, bro? I'm like, dude, I'm not.
That is Joe Lopez.
Yeah, bro. And here I am in ministry. You know what I heard the most? And you're a man of God. You call yourself a Christian, you know? And I'm like, whoa, whoa, whoa. I wasn't supposed to be there. Look at YouTube. We gave the band away.
Right.
So I had to make a move. My brother Oscar and my brother Edgar, they were really upset because I gave the band away, first of all. And then when all this started happening, my brother Edgar and Oscar heard about, you know, all the craziness that was going on. And people thought that I would be there because they were told that. They told me, just get the name back. Get the name back if you can't. I said, the name is already there. I mean, Fama Enterprises Inc. is still under my name.
Yeah.
And so we ended up doing Javier Galván y su grupo Fama LLC.
Mm-hmm.
Legally, I mean, above board. I mean, we did it the right way. And now we're traveling. We're celebrating 35 years of Fama music.
Praise God, man. Yeah. Hell
God
yeah.
Is yeah.
Awesome.
Yep. You know what? And imagine if they had signed it. And under their name, bro.
Yeah.
I mean, you'd have to go back into the courtroom and litigation and make sure that people don't know. You'd have to go on a campaign to make sure people understand that you're not part of that, uh, that, that, that whole situation.
Right. Right. Yeah. And that breaks my heart because really we were like family. Mm-hmm. You know, we were like family. We're like family. Yeah. You know, we grew up together. And giving the band to the guys, and then for them to take me to court a year later because we did a toy drive in Corpus and some other events with the promoters or whoever, because I'm they right away they see Javier, they say Fama.
Yeah.
So they promoted as Javier Galvan y su La Voz de Fama. Mm-hmm. And because I used the name Fama, they sued me. Now they sued me and they don't even have the name that I gave them. You know? They never assumed the name. It's like, what are you doing? I mean, finding out now. You know,
Tenían el abogado de Breaking Bad, okay?
Well, I tell Javier like this, yeah, okay, whatever happened like that. But really and seriously, man, you didn't go through all the pain and all that we went through, where, you know, like certain little things when this band was growing up and doing this.
The
I'm
growing
like, come
pains,
on, man.
Man.
You know, like.
Yeah, so that was a big old deal.
And so what happened with the lawsuit? They must have thrown it out of court, right?
It was thrown out of court. The lawsuit, well. We were negotiating, and so at the end of it, nobody won.
But what was the negotiation about if the name wasn't even under their name, bro?
We didn't know. I didn't know that.
Oh, you didn't know yet.
I didn't know. No. I didn't know because really, in my, I just wanted it to go away. Like, nobody, what do you want? So I called one day. I said, what is it that you want, John? What do y'all want? And he says, why don't we work it out where you'll do some gigs with us? And I did. I did some gigs, but I told him, as long as I can play one or two gospel songs or inspirational songs in the middle of it, I'll do it, but I got to get paid. I said, I'm not doing this for free. You're going to pay me. I'm going to get there, and I do my own negotiating. I got my people. They're going to negotiate my contract, and I'll be there. Mm-hmm. I'll do it. Con todo gusto, I'll do it. I'll sign autographs. I'll take pictures. I'll smile, you know? and so
professional.
And that's what we did. And every time that we would go and play, what would happen is there was a fight. There was a fight with promoters, and I have affidavit from promoters. The last time we played at Social, one guy came up to the drummer, to Eddie, and
I liked it because I got to charge more. And he came along. I told my cousin, hey, since you're going to pay him, I want more también.
But what were the fights about, or what? Nomás era gente
peleando. What would happen that time?
Nomás, it would just be either something to do with on stage, either song list or the promoters like
didn't
just
want to pay them.
Yeah, or didn't pay.
What a bitch of drama! Any,
yeah, it was a lot of drama. Man. It was very stressful.
It was
very
crazy,
stressful, bro. I would just step away. I had my own merchandise table.
Javier was over there waiting.
Con
el cheque y todo, he was good.
Deja tú. No. Y si hay de andas con la esposa ahí, y nomás te está dando los death stares, like chinga. Yeah. What are you getting yourself into? Right?
No, I just do this with the check.
Let them say whatever they want, honey. Vámonos.
you know, let me just clear this up. I wish them well. I do. But lo que es correcto es correcto. What's right is right.
That's all it is.
You know, if you couldn't handle 10 years of having that opportunity, because I blessed them with that. Mira, no me pagaron for that. I didn't ask for anything, anything in exchange.
God blessed them through you.
I gave it to them, and they couldn't do the right thing. I mean, bro, I mean, it just didn't make sense to me. But anyhow, so now we're touring. We're doing the 35 years.
And it's just you and Israel?
And truth be told, if I knew that it was all BS, I would not be here right now. And I have that same feeling. And just to let the public know, I'm here. And I know it's going to be real, and we're going
to
be back.
And you've been around long enough to know better.
I know better.
You know? Yeah. You've got your stripes, man.
And I got scars. I got some bad scars. Bad scars. You got your
medals and your 10-year pin. And
No, but I wish them well, bro, because at the end of the day, here's my deal. I believe that God gave me a platform so that I can spread the love. Not to preach. My life preaches. I don't have to say a word. You know, but God gave me a platform to be able to show the love of God to people, bring encouragement, bring hope. We have a radio program called La Fe Cafe, and it runs all over the U.S. And
is it on YouTube and Spotify as a podcast or anything?
You know
like
what?
That?
A podcast. I always say iPodcast. Yeah. A podcast. Yeah. No, it's not yet. But we're running it through terrestrial radio stations.
Okay.
And so
you need to open up a YouTube channel and download or upload all the programs. Mm-hmm. As soon as you're done with them, upload them on YouTube, And then that way people have an opportunity to go back to the archives of any show that they might need for that certain moment in their life.
Yeah.
Yes.
That they're going through a certain struggle and they remember
they
hearing
can push
that.
It there, yeah.
They remember hearing you say something that was going to remind them and make them feel better. And they can go into your YouTube channel, go through your collection, your playlist, your archives, and hit that particular moment when you gave them some words of encouragement yeah. for the situation
and
that
right
they're going
now,
through right now.
Yeah. And right now it's needed. Yeah. It's needed. So next time you see me, I'm going to have my shirt instead of instead of Telosico, say a word, the
yeah,
word of
yeah,
God.
Yeah, 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 man. Hell yeah.
But you know, I wish him well.
And I go, hell yeah. Hell yeah. Chinga el diablo again.
This is the show. This is part of the show.
Did you catch it right now? Hace rato he said, praise God. And he goes, yes. And I go, hell yeah. I was like, wait a second.
Oh,
what
goodness.
Are you doing, bro? Chinga, bro.
You double-minded.
Hey, estoy bipolar de madre, carnal. Asustame one time. So how big did Fama Enterprises get, man, during the 90s? And
oh, man. We
I mean,
big.
How much do you think it was worth when you thought you had given them the name?
Well, at that point, it wasn't worth what it used to be worth. But at one point, we were making, you know, $25, $30 million a year. You know, and that was, you know, that was good money for Tejano Band.
Wow,
and
man.
I remember we did 5 gigs in one day. Correct me if I'm wrong. Remember we got the jet.
We
flew from Houston, I think, to San
Antonio.
To the Valley. Well, I know it was like 4 or 5 places we flew to. And
then
the
it rained at the last one. It was a 4th of July. We were at Stinson.
We're flying back. And I don't want to say too much, but I am going to say it.
Say it, bro.
We were gone, dude. Oh and take
hey,
it to,
the plane. The plane wasn't the only thing that had you
hey,
high.
Yeah, right. The pilot's gone. Este, no, take a shot. I'm like, dude, what are you doing, bro? The pilot, yeah, give me no one.
And
like,
then
dude.
The power goes out.
The pilot goes.
Oh no.
The pilot. Yes. The pilot goes. Give me a shot. I'm nervous. This is my first time flying.
When we got there, I was really buzzing, but I was like, thank you God.
Dude, $30 million a year. I thought
we were making some cash, baby.
But we had a lot of expenses. We had 26 people that worked for us. We had the road crew. We had the 18-wheeler. We had the bus. We had the
pero
box.
$30 million, carna, como quiera. Que tanto, how much were you guys
Let me
taking
see, I put,
home, bro?
I put Diamond through college. I put Cherry through other top of the
bench. Oh, my goodness.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Hey, that was before. We had
that was
to,
way before, man.
We had to go through the test to have a testimony. Can I hear a hallelujah?
Plus, I remember you. I'll never forget the white bus, dude. You guys had that white bus. Yeah. And by the way, now that you guys are talking about flying, right, flying from different... you all, actually, that was one of your album covers, no? You guys were on
a poster,
jet.
A poster that we had.
Y yo estaba diciendo, estaba teniendo tren jet hasta que traje.
No, we were...
Está rentado ese pedo. You know, $30 million a year.
Mira, let me tell you something. I don't know where that money went. You know, and that's when we were living like, I mean, we were dancing with the devil, brother.
A lot of people would tell me, too, man, what'd you do with all that? I said, it doesn't matter. But I'll never... I don't regret any of those. Those were some good times.
You're
man.
Like Buff Bagwell. I shouldn't have bought that mansion, yeah. man. I shouldn't have bought that mansion, man.
I had some really good times, and like I say, the scars, they're healing, and it's gonna come back, and we're gonna be all right.
Y de ahí se les acabó el dinero y buscaron diosito, de cabrones.
No, actually, when I gave my life to the Lord, a mí se me apareció la muerte, bro. That's why I was coked up and
what
drunk.
What the hell?
Yeah, exactly.
Damn.
And so it was on July 15th, 2001. I was drinking and doing cocaine as I had been doing for every day for about since my dad passed away. My dad passed away April 22nd, 1999. Mm-hmm. And then on July 15th, it was a Sunday afternoon at about 7 o'clock at night, or no, about 9 o'clock at night. I saw the spirit of death, and I was drunk and coked up. Se me quitó lo borracho, se me quitó todo. I got so scared. I tell people I started speaking in tongues. Well, la muerte, you know?
Yeah, no, you hallucinate.
Yeah, well.
I would get to the point where I'd see shadows in my kitchen. Like, yeah. You remember that movie Ghost?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And then when the bad guy would die, those shadows that would come out.
dude, I'd be in my home alone after like 7 days of no sleep, just getting high just and shit. Yeah. And I'd look at the kitchen and there was like shadows walking in my floor. And I was like, man, I got to stop, dude. And then I went out to the door. I went to the door and I looked out the window, you know, because I was paranoid, right?
I told my old man.
And I saw, it was at night. It was like 4 a.m. And I saw two like humanoids fighting in my driveway, dude, man. And I was like looking at like, what the hell's going on? And then it just turned into the rim of my truck, right? And I thought, instead of me saying, a la madre, I need to stop, I was like, okay, loco, bro, you know? I was gone, dude. Yeah. I mean, I was done, bro. Yeah. I mean, it was, I felt like I was almost at the point of no return, but fortunately, I got my shit together, man, and I went to rehab. And I'm going on 14 years in June,
praise
man.
God, yeah. Yeah. Praise God. No, all right.
You know, puro pinche chamomile, carnal. Puro té.
That's it, man.
For la digestion.
That relaxes you.
Yeah, man. But, man, dude, that's interesting. I would have never thought 30 million, man. A lot of Tejano artists were making some big bucks like that, right, bro?
Yeah. Well, we were going to Mexico a lot, too. And, I mean, over there, los conciertos son masivos. And, and everything that we did, it was, I believe that now, because we squandered it. I mean, ex-wives and this and that, you know. And now I believe that God prepared us so that we can be a better steward of what we're going to receive with you know, what
ya después
doing.
De atole.
Hey, todavía podemos.
Así estoy ahorita, estoy tratando de aventar unos $10 para el retirement, carnal. Pero le pego 63 and unos $10 para allá, carnal. You know, trying to build something up, bro. Pero, you know, better late than never. But, man, I mean, if we only would have known back then.
Oh, yeah. My God.
Because sometimes it's like Buff Bagwell. I was like, that guy thought that his career was never going to end. It was going to keep going. And sometimes, you know, I mean... What happened to Tejano, dude, in the 90s? I mean, all the labels left, right? Gibby Velasquez was saying something about that. You know, that they came in and they did all this and that, and then they took off and left everybody kind of high and dry.
Well, the regional Mexicans started taking over.
Right.
The production for...
The Norteño and stuff?
The Norteño, the banda.
Intocable, 98. They came out around 98.
Yep. And, well, they were successful because they followed that trend, you know, and which was great. I mean, they're still doing, making noise and doing well. But it's not what it used to be. Tejano is not what it used to be. I mean, and then the productions that were coming out are horrible, you know. And they just to start off with the Spanish language. I mean, they say ya, quiero que vengas para atrás. Instead of saying quiero que regreses,
it's not correct Spanish. No. And, it's Tejano.
Yeah, and
it's
the Tejano Mexican word. The Mexicans doesn't accept that. You know, Mexican does not accept. That type.
Pero Monterrey dicen palabras aquí.
Monterrey will accept it, but that's just one small market. Yeah. You know, I mean, it's a big market.
You want to go to Mexico City? Oh, you want to go to Michoacán?
Yeah, you gotta.
Yeah, all those places. Yeah, because I remember being in the studio with Selena, and they had Manolo in there from Capital EMI. Yeah. I don't know what he's up to or if he's still around, but I remember he was there, and I was like, "Why is Manolo here?" And he was there to help them. Correctly pronounce words to help Selena correctly pronounce the words because Pita Studio and they were starting to do those songs, and that's what happened with Selena. She changed her lyrically, they changed, and that's when it crossed over to Mexico. You know, that was very important for them. And then I heard and I thought Joe Lopez was doing it, La Mafia, they were all beginning to use correct Spanish.
Well, Jose Rosario was the Manolo in Sony, you know?
Yeah. He was a nice guy, bro. He was one of the nicest guys.
We wrote some songs together. Amor, Perdóname.
Yeah.
He wrote the second part of La Despedida, the song that I wrote for my dad when he passed away. We wrote a lot of songs together. But he would go in there and he would correct my Spanish, you know, or correct the different artists that were in the studio. Mm-hmm. And so that was very important. And I think that a lot of the productions were coming out where they didn't have the budget for that, or the bands would take the budget and use it for something else. You know, oh man, look, he's got a new car, pero sacó un disco feo. You know,
yeah, man.
So, but you know, it is what it is. And now I think there was a restart button with this COVID for so many things.
Yeah,
and I think that right now people are hungry for this. Not only Tejano, but to get out and attend these outdoor events because they're outdoors more than anything.
Get some vitamin D under that sun, dude, you know?
Yeah, and so we were doing a lot of acoustic events during COVID. And as a matter of fact, we're going to be tomorrow Tomorrow?
Yeah.
Tomorrow we're going to be at Los Mismos here in the Valley.
Oh, yeah. It's at a restaurant, right?
It's a restaurant.
Yeah, no está con madre la comida ahí, bro. Yeah. It's good.
I can't wait.
Yeah. We're going to be there. And so those are the types of events that we're doing. We're doing acoustic events.
¿Dónde va a ser? ¿A cuál Mismos? Yo quiero ir, bro.
Los Mismos. Yeah, it's going to be the one on North Jackson. North Jackson, right?
Oh, I know where that is. Yeah. Over there, getting close to Trenton.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. That's the one we're going to be at tomorrow. Orale, tomorrow
man.
Night.
And hell, ladies and gentlemen, go by there, man. Tienen la comida tan sabrosa.
It is, man. We ate there yesterday.
Yeah, man. Tienen unos mariscos en yaqueas, bro. Unas tortillas en refried beans, enchiladitas, fajitas.
Hijo
de su. Tienen el ceviche.
Ahorita. Israel.
Otra vez.
Se oía la tripa de Israel.
Before it was about partying, now it's just about eating.
Yeah. And medications, bro.
Everybody says that about me, man. So we can't go on the road. You can't go on the road, dude, because you want to stop at every Stripes and grab a taco or los chips y una sodita y todo. And I was like, dude,
that's
I love it.
Yeah, man. So, man, so that, now you've got Fama. You're starting to perform and where can people
let me
find
just clarify
you,
this you know? Real quick. Eddie and the guys, whoever he has, they're doing just Fama.
There's two Famas there?
Well, they're doing their Fama. I have Javier Galván y su grupo.
But Fama. How can they use Fama if you got the can't you take them to court for that? Or cease and desist?
I could.
We'll leave them there.
Yeah.
We'll leave them there because everybody, the truth be told, I mean, the people who are watching this and all that, come on, man, let's just be honest. Aquí está Fama. And that's all to it. Yeah. Let them do their thing. I see that nobody gets in a big old
I don't want to fight over that, you know? Because what people should know is this, that if it doesn't have Javier Galván y su grupo Fama on the contract,
it's not Javier Galván.
It's Fama. Well, it's not. I'm not going to be there.
Yeah.
And that's the reason that I did it, because a lot of people were hurt by thinking that I was going to be there.
Yeah.
You know, these are important dates. It's only one time you can do a quinceañera or a wedding or a 50th anniversary or whatever. You know, we got letters, bro. We got letters and affidavits saying, look, they did this, boom, 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 and they promised this. And, you know, and so it's like, okay, we'll make it right. Javier Galván y su grupo Fama, I have an LLC. We're going to move forward. We're going to celebrate 35 years of music, and we're going to put out some new music and play some of the old music and some gospel.
And we're bringing that white bus back, bro.
I don't know about the
bus. I came out of
the bus. There was a Silver Eagle, right?
Yeah, it was a Silver Eagle.
Dude, those are old school, dude. Those are awesome, bro. Yeah. Whatever happened to that bus?
I think it broke
in
half or
it
something.
Broke in half. No,
we sold it to.
Hey, if they spray luminol in there, no me cállate la boca, shit, out all DNA, carnal. Va a aparecer forensic file. Hey, no vas a necesitar que prender las luces del bus, va a glow todo el pinche pedo, carnal.
All I have to say is thank God we didn't have Facebook, bro.
Yeah, dude. Oh, my God. Or cell phones, bro.
If that bus could talk, nombre. No, dude. That, I mean, seriously.
Yes. Le echas luminol y hace glow todo el pinche bono. They can see it from space and shit, dude. The glow, all the DNA glowing and shit, man.
Who ended up with that bus?
Lupe from Liberacion.
Liberacion, verdad?
Yeah, Liberacion. Yeah.
He's got it or what?
Yeah.
He bought it. I don't know if he still has it, but he
I got a bus.
Dude.
Yeah, tengo un Silver Eagle 83, bro.
Oh, yeah?
Chinga. I used to have hair when I bought it, bro.
Yep.
Neta, bro, chingado, but
every time you move a bus or an RV, it's going to cost you money. I mean, you come back and, oh, se le quedó esto, y ay, se le quedó, all the time.
Deja tú, pero I love it. I love the bus, bro. Yeah.
It's that feeling.
It's like it's like that. Yeah, it's like chingao, man. I mean, because they offered me like $30,000 for it, right? And I was like, chingao, ya está pagado el pinche bus, you know? Yeah. Yo lo puedo estar componiendo ahí poquito a poquito ahí. You know, damos la vuelta. It gets us to the gigs, and I get to take a nap before the show now, right?
It used to be, hey, we can party in the night. Yeah. Let's just take a nap.
Antes no me dormíamos todos los tres días, carnal, tres gigs. Yo estoy we need the bus. I need to take a nap before the show.
Pero si te bañas, antes no.
Man, but you guys got to travel from coast to coast in Mexico and all that, man.
Yeah, we made the mistake of taking our bus to Mexico. when we get when we got back, todo le temblaba al bolso because all them holes, you know.
Todas las llantas, you know.
Se fueron por Crater Avenue.
That's where Selena got carcacha from.
No, but it was scary over there. Like, you know, we're talking to Tony Guerrero. They crashed with their bus on that mountain, dude.
Yeah, yeah. Man, that was
and
scary.
And then Intocable had an accident over there. So
our manager, Angel Gonzalez, tied with Intocable. Yeah. It was his first day there.
Angel Gonzalez, that's right.
Remember Angel?
Man. That was terrible. Eli Pepe, bro.
Yeah, they died.
Yeah, dude. Yeah. And then Intocable comes out with that amazing song. La Mio que se fue.
Man, that thing was right on it, man.
And then they put their voices in the beginning of the song, and it's just like real ominous, real. Yeah. Man, what a song, bro. What do you think of Intocable's songwriting, bro? I saw Ricky. We saw him in November.
Yes.
And his singing has just gotten so amazing.
You know, it's amazing how, and I believe this with all my heart, not because I'm a minister or whatever, but I believe that God prepares each one of us, like you on radio. That's you, man. And your voice is perfect for what you're doing and the incredible things that you guys are doing. I mean, it's a team. But I believe that God prepares you for that. And I believe that Intocable, they're phenomenal, just like with Jesse Turner. I mean, phenomenal songwriting and what he plays and all that. It's just amazing. And it's just perfect for him. I couldn't do what they do. You know, I do my thing. But I admire what Ricky has done. And not only Ricky, but his whole team, his whole staff. His whole
when they went and created their own label, and, man, that was like a big step for them, man. Because, I mean, to have a label and to create a label in an industry where there's monster corporate labels that control everything and can blackball you and stuff like that, man, they excelled, man. I mean, it was their talent, their music, their writing, their vocals. Man, you got to commend those guys, man.
And they connected with some big artists, Arjona, you know, all these big artists that they collaborated with.
Yeah, man.
You know, with Cumbia Kings and things like that, people like that. It's just incredible how they se acoplaron. You know, it's incredible.
Yeah, he can blend. But when I was watching him singing, I was like, he sang this ballad, right? And I was like, man, I wonder if he's taking like singing lessons, you know, because like Bon Jovi, he used to take singing lessons throughout the road, you know, the breathing, because there's a trick to singing. And the song that he was singing was like one of those songs that are like, man, they're not easy to sing, dude. You know what I mean?
I think it's titled Quiero Ser.
Quiero Ser, I think.
Quiero Ser Yo.
It was an amazing ballad, dude. And I just was blown away with Ricky's vocals. And I was like, I wonder if he ever like takes breathing lessons and stuff like that. Because it's like anything else. You get better at your craft and what you're doing. And then you know, you excel. And sometimes they don't have to do that. They just normally, you know, naturally evolve into the better singer, musician, and all that. But man, I was really impressed with Ricky, man.
You're making me think maybe I should get some voice lessons.
Yeah, they come a long way, well, man. That's a great group, man.
Yeah, I don't see why. What's the bad thing about doing that? Even no matter how big of an artist you are, you
of know, course, like I was saying, there's always something new coming out or something that they find out.
Yeah,
you know?
It's like Bon Jovi when I read a long while back when he was like at the top of his game. He was they interviewed him and he was saying, "No, I have a vocal coach." And I'm taking lessons, and I'm learning how to breathe and how to properly, you know, there's tricks to the throat, the tongue, everything, man.
Yeah.
And I was like, you know what? Bon Jovi's looking to perfect and better his product, and there's nothing wrong with that. I know a lot of people think that that's like, you know, I don't take no lessons. I'm natural, you know.
To this day, if I see man, there's got a lot of great musicians out there in every kind of industry, and if I'm talking to a keyboard player and I want to learn that, I don't care what it makes me look like. I'll like tell a man, teach me. Or let me, can I watch you? Because I want to learn it.
Yeah. It's just like my son. My son was going for sound engineering and vocal lessons and guitar. And he was just learning all kinds of stuff. And I learned a little bit from my son, you know, from what he was doing. And I applied it. I've been applying it to what I do. He sings in San Antonio at two different churches, Cornerstone Church and Friendship Church. Mm-hmm. And so I've seen how... And he's doing amazing, you know, and his voice, my son's range is like incredible, but it is the breathing. And I learned a little trick, some little tricks from him, you know, so it's never too late.
Cause where are you getting better?
El Yoño me enseñó.
But there's like, sometimes you're singing and you have to sing all these words and you run out of breath.
Yeah, like Ojitos yeah. Color Café. Yeah. Dime que me quieres mucho, que poquito a poco me has ido queriendo, que es una verdad, es lo que estoy sufriendo, ya no seas ingrata, no me hagas sufrir.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Pues eso, ya me lo hago.
I was waiting for him to say Whataburger in Walmart again, man. You know what I mean? Oh. He remembers those lyrics.
I got dizzy.
Yeah. Te pegó un buzz. Yeah. Oh, man. So, speaking of son, how many kids you got, bro?
I have four. I have three girls and a boy. I'm a grandpa now.
You are?
Yes.
How old are your kids?
My daughter, Nikki, is 32. Mm-hmm. My daughter, Brianna, is 26. Javi is 20 years old. And then Christabel is 14 years old.
So, 89 was your firstborn then? Right when you guys were about to hit it off, bro. Wow, how was that?
88.
88? All right, so the 88, so she'll be 33 this year.
Yeah. Yes.
So, but how was that, dude? I mean, was it tough?
¿Cómo andabas, Gabriel?
Yeah.
I was already partying.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Man,
Jesus.
What about you, Israel?
That's where I was going to say. It's almost about the same thing. Because I have a daughter and three boys. And my oldest son is about the same age as his first. Mm-hmm. And it goes down like 33, 32, and then I think 29. And then my youngest is 9. Mm-hmm. So.
And
I was done when I started over, and thank God, because I was real lost.
What
man.
A blessing, yeah.
And it was a blessing.
His son keeps him in line, man. That's a beautiful thing.
And I'm not lying. He really does.
Yeah, you know, the kids growing up through the 90s, well, we were the craziest. And, you know, I mean, there's a lot of things that, you know, we had to make amends for, you know, with our children, bro, you know, because I'm in the same boat. And, you know, to be able to rebuild a relationship with your children after putting them through hell with any type of situation like drug addiction or alcoholism, and being an artist as well, a musician that's always on the road, never home, and when they're home, they're doing their own thing. And it takes work, you know, but I'm here to say that it can happen.
Yeah.
I mean, I have my son and my daughter on my show, dude, you know. Wow. And so, you know, it just takes work. And don't give up, you know, because they'll come around, you know. They'll come around. Are your relationships with your kids, are they pretty cool? Or
they're good.
Yeah, my relationship with my daughter, Nikki, my oldest, is really good. I get to FaceTime. Because of COVID, I get to FaceTime with my grandbaby. I mean, it's beautiful, man. Mm-hmm. It's incredible to be a grandfather, you know. Mm-hmm. And then my Brianna... that relationship is a little different because of the divorce, you know, back in 95 or 97. Anyhow, just
do you
a little
do you keep contact with her? Do you talk with her?
We
do you
try.
Text?
Yeah, we try. It's not as effective. I try every day to try to.
Even if they don't respond, dude, you need to keep texting them. And
I have a buddy
of
mine that says that.
You
I
know,
have a buddy
even if they don't respond, you text them and you make sure that you know they're still alive and that you're here for them. You never know that one text is going to make a big difference. Yeah. You know, if they don't answer the phone, you text them and you make them understand that. You know, it was what it was, and it's not what it is anymore.
Absolutely.
And,
absolutely.
And that's what it takes. It takes perseverance for anything in life, man, you know, to succeed.
I have a buddy of mine, Freddie. He always tells me, hey, did you text your daughters? Did you text your, you know, and making sure that I do that. And that helps me because I do, it reminds me to do that every day, you know. Mm-hmm. And my son, I mean, we have an awesome relationship. My son is
the singer.
Yeah, he plays guitar, piano, and sings.
He's a chip off the old block.
He taught him how to play the piano. Bobby taught him how to play guitar,
man,
and then he started.
Yeah, his kid was like he was fast.
He was about 5 years old.
He was jamming, dude. I was like, damn. But no, it's good. I'm the same way. I text my kids. Oh, man. I go back through the years, and I tell everybody, you know what? It was bad, man.
Yeah.
So I had to fix all that, and it was hard.
Yeah,
it was
make
really
like
hard,
you said.
Man.
Do you all ever see pictures of your kids when they were little, and then you're like, God, what was I thinking, dude?
What was the matter with you, man?
I'll get a picture, and I'll send it to my son or my daughters, you know, like, hey, check this out. And they start, they start laughing or whatever, you know.
Yeah, man. Well, that's awesome, bro.
But thank God that it's good, man, really, because that haunted me for a long time.
Yeah.
And now that everything's better, man, thank you, Jesus.
Dude, that can wear you down, bro. Oh, you know, it's a guilt, you know, and you have to let it go, and you have to, or be proactive,
right,
to get rid of that guilt, man. You know, and the best way to do it is to keep pushing at it. You know, keep making sure that they understand that, hey, you're thinking of them every single day, and you're here. You need some, I'm here, and they'll come around, man. Yep. And hopefully, and if they don't, well,
at least say
it's
no that
because,
you sent them a text.
Yeah, right. Least, you know, your side of the street was, you know,
yeah,
you know, cleaned, and we tried our best, and but usually it works, bro.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, I would imagine, you know.
Yep.
I mean, there's a lot of fathers that go through that, bro.
Yeah. Look, at the end of it, God always wins.
And you don't have to be an artist or, you know, to be in a situation like the artists are. But we did have a different, you know, lifestyle because of the road and, you know, the radio, the scene, the music, the Tejano industry, and then all the money that was floating around, you know. Mm-hmm. I mean, no se acababa in those 90s, bro. We made it through the 90s, bro.
I mean, oh my gosh, think about that one. Whoa, I like that one.
Yeah, dude.
We made it. That's another t-shirt.
I made it through the 90s.
There you go.
That's the next t-shirt.
You know what? I tell him that all the time, too. I was like, dude, you know, like, man, there's a purpose, man. It has, for me, there is. You know what? I'm speaking for myself. There has to be a purpose because I'm still here.
Yeah. God ain't done yet.
I'm still here, man. And I said, hey, I'm not going nowhere. Yeah. I got to finish the book, you know, that he's written for me. Because, man, I should have been gone a long time ago.
Yeah.
Thank God I'm not, and we're going to make this happen.
God is good, man.
Are you living in Houston?
San Antonio.
In San Antonio, and you're in Houston?
Bay City, Texas.
Ahí vive el primo mío.
Sí.
Se llama Joshua.
Joshua
Gonzalez.
Does he play accordion?
Yeah, well, he's with the Kings. What's his name?
I think I've met him before.
Los Reyes.
Yeah.
Yeah, he plays congas.
Right.
Yeah, es mi primo.
Awesome.
My cousin, his dad was a singer for a band called Sangre Viva back in the 70s, and they moved up to Houston, most of them. It was my uncle and my cousins. They were my cousins. And so they moved to Bay City, and that's where they're living, man. I went over there because I wanted to interview my cousin, who's my mom. He's my mom's cousin, and he's older than my mom, dude, mm-hmm. You know? And he's about 70. He's my dad's age. But I wanted to sit down with him and talk to him about the back in the days, you know, the 70s, because they had like Agustin Ramirez type music. And I remember growing up in the 70s, my parents had Little Joe, Agustin Ramirez, Freddie Martinez, all these things, you know. But man, so Bay City, that's in Bay City,
yeah,
man.
Yeah, it's a small town. I never thought I'd end up there, but it's good.
Yeah, and so when you guys get together, no tan lejos San Antonio de Houston, ¿verdad?
We're close.
3 horas.
We're close. About
3 hours.
And what do the gigs look like? Are they starting to pick up, man?
They are. We're busy this week and this whole month. One of the things that we're working on is our CD. I wanted to put together a 35-year anniversary CD, but you know, I'm old school. And
El anthology.
Yeah. Well, I wanted to do something like that, but they told me nobody's doing that anymore. They're doing four or five or six songs.
Number two.
Yeah.
You know, just really.
Two.
And so we had an emergency meeting. Me, my wife, and... Oh, you didn't show up.
Well,
was that Bay City, carnal?
That's right. No, but we decided, you know what? Let's just put an EP out. And it's probably going to be 4 or 5 songs. And so we're...
Los carros ya no tienen CD player, carnal.
Uh-uh. No.
They don't have CD player. So, you know, it has to be... What you can do is record 5 songs and release one every 2 weeks.
Yep.
You know,
and that's what they're doing.
Exactly.
Every 2-3 weeks, they're releasing a song. It's like incredible. Before, it was what? 6 weeks, 8 weeks, 10 weeks?
Or record a song and then make the video and release it.
Yeah.
And then while it's released, record another song or you have the other song and make the video for it. You can record 5 songs and be making videos, you know, and it doesn't take much. You could make a video of your song with an iPhone, bro.
Yep.
You know, I mean, it doesn't take like the thousands and thousands of dollars anymore.
You know, the style that I really learned to appreciate is Cristian Nodal. You know, that trumpet and the mariachi. I love mariachi music.
A ver, how's it? Cristian Nodal?
Cristian Nodal. Nodal. N-O-D-A-L. Cristian Nodal.
Nodal. N-O-D-A-L.
Yeah.
Órale. Cristian Nodal. Vamos a ver. A ver qué está hablando. Vamos a ver.
Gente quiere gatita. Órale, gita.
Está chavalón. Son chavalos.
Yeah. I love that, man. That's just so fat, so
romanticism.
Yeah, yeah. You know, I thought about doing that with Te Voy a Enseñar.
Do it.
I think I am.
Miro tus ojos y no eres feliz. Y tu mirada no sabe mentir.
I've never heard of this guy.
Yeah, yeah.
Had you been?
No, not at all.
Really?
Así.
Have you heard of Los Dos Carnales?
No.
Estos eran los...
Ah, estos eran...
No, no, no. No, man, but these guys are... They're doing like... they're huge, bro.
They're super huge.
They're freaking
really?
Huge. Yeah.
Super huge. I mean, I'm yeah.
Los Carnales.
Los Carnales.
Come on, Rock, for real. Is it a group or is it just... Uh-oh.
Oy!
Déjame sacar la tequila, cuñado. Órale. Me la trajo el de Mattress Firm anoche. Nos vamos a poner del dron.
Is that what he brought?
Pura agua bendita, carnal. Pura agua bendita.
Tú que sabes de pobreza si has vivido entre riqueza. Muchas veces la cabeza nada ayuda aunque le piensas.
Watch esta.
Yo estresaba mi guitarra exigiéndole grandeza.
They're so young too.
Yeah,
right?
Tan chavalos. 21 years old.
Really? What?
And the singer's 28.
Man, it's not like old guys.
Uh-huh. And then I got some you know, some stuff.
That's my favorite.
I love that. I like that.
Who's that?
Let's see if you know. Wait a minute. This is a song that me and my wife used to listen to when we were dating. The album. Todo el pinche album está bruto. The voice is going to give it away right now.
Big time. I'm surprised they don't know it already.
Oh, yeah.
Hey. Prometí olvidarte.
Pepe Aguilar.
Yeah.
That's beautiful, man.
I interviewed Pepe Aguilar when I had Dímelo.
Uh-huh.
We went to Miami. I interviewed Enrique Iglesias, Shakira, Pepe Aguilar. He's a tall guy. Well, everybody's tall to me, but this guy was really... Hey.
He's a tall guy. Oh, he's 5'4"?
five. He's actually, I think he was 6'7", 6'6".
Si? Hombre, he's that tall.
He's tall. Yeah, he's a big old dude.
Fuimos a verlo aquí en el Pain Arena y mm-hmm. We had front row seats, you know.
Yep.
Y ver la baby doll está haciendo, tú sabes, punto canal. Tú te sientas enfrente, baby. Y de ahí estaba Pepe en aquel lado del stage entrando unas toallas, ¿entiendes? Y se le avientaba las rucas. Yeah.
He would wipe his sweat.
Y le dije a mi wife, le dije, guacharita, ven y te la va a aventar a ti. Vino pinche Pepe y le aventó la toalla. Yeah.
He didn't throw it. He handed it to me.
And then
es que es caballero.
And then a friend of mine that's an attorney was sitting next to me, and we weren't together. And he sees me with my wife and me, you know, and he goes, does she have a sister, bro?
No, but she has a towel.
No. And I said,
cochino.
I said, no, but they're all taken, bro. Well, does she have a dog at least?
A dog handler.
Hasta el perro.
I want the dog.
Yeah.
Yeah, man. Javier, man, let me tell you, bro, it's awesome having you here, man.
Thank you so much, Rock.
And I appreciate you and bringing Israel, man. I mean, I hadn't seen Israel in a long time. He's usually the guy that I would run off with when I'd go hang out with you guys, man.
And I was usually the guy that, ¿dónde se fueron? Yeah. Se llevaron todo.
Or if I ended up at an after party after some shebang going on in San Antonio, I'd end up there and he'd be the only one I recognized in that party. Oye, ¿estás acá tú también, carnal?
I know you got some.
Yeah, hey,
dale pa'l baño, carnal.
You know, I think about that and it like inside it just like, oh, because it shakes.
Yeah, man.
It's
like, man,
those are horrible memories.
Do you ever have dreams?
Not anymore, but
dreams
I had,
of using, you know?
You know what? I had a bad dream, man. I'm not going to lie to you. So I was still, it was heavy, man. I was even heavier than when you knew me back in those days. And I told Javier, I'm sleeping one night, man. I have this dream, and I hope there's not any, it's not the nasty, it's just the truth. I'm not lying.
Dale,
so, in my dream, this devil, man, he's opening up my mouth. And he's like, I'm coming in. And in my dream, I can't fight him. But I said, man, I don't belong to you, man. I belong to Jesus. And you ain't coming in. And you ain't taking over me. And it seemed like forever. And when I said that, I got up. And I just stood up like that, man. And I didn't know what to even think. I didn't even know what to do. And the girl that I was staying with at that time, she's like, dude, it seemed like you were fighting with somebody. I said, I was. She goes, who? I said, the devil. Well, needless to say, we never saw each other again, but it was a true dream, man. And that time, that's when I was like, dude, that's it, bro. Like,
yeah,
it
was too real.
And you fought this cat, man. Like, you actually, you know, and I never would use that. Hey, man, I belong to Jesus. I never did, mm-hmm. but that it would just seem true. And from that, it was good, man. It was good for me, man.
I would have dreams that I'm out using, you know. Yeah. Ando amanecido en una parte, ando con unos
vatos. And then you feel horrible, right?
Ando con mafiosos, bro. Yeah. La chingada, hermano. Like, we used to hang out with those mafiosos and shit, you know. And they all had guns and shit. And then me ponían bien perno, chacan el cuete, no están viendo.
And it seems so real.
And like, I'll wake up like, oh, what? Yeah, I'm here in bed. Oh,
thank you, Lord.
And then I would tell my sponsor, right? I tell him, hey, man, I'm having dreams of using cocaine, dude, and alcohol and shit, bro. He goes, oh, yeah, rock. Se llamaba Hal Kelly.
Hal Kelly.
Era Houston Negro. Oh, yeah, man, have fun with those, man. You know, enjoy those dreams, rock. I'm like, what do you mean enjoy them? Well, you get to go and do all the fucking shit you used to always do, and you don't even have to leave your bed. You don't even leave your bed. Just enjoy them, relax, enjoy them.
Hey, but you feel really bad for the rest of the day because you keep thinking about that dream because it seems so real, right?
It was real, bro. Yeah, yeah. I mean, there's been some dreams that I wake up and they're real, dude. I mean, and it's about using and being out there lost like I was before, you know? No, it's not there no more, man. And as I got farther away from my last day of using, they started, like, I don't hardly get them anymore at all, but I was getting them quite a bit when I was starting my freaking, you know, rehab and shit. Now, you know, I'm good. Everything's good. And I'm going, like I said, on 14 years in June. And
awesome.
And life is beautiful, man.
It is, man. It is. Know? It's incredible how it turns around once you stop using, once you stop that lifestyle, you know.
The relationships can be recovered.
Oh, absolutely. You make amends.
Yeah, you make amends and relationships, and you feel better about yourself because they've accepted your apology. Yeah. And even when they don't,
you know that you did your part, you know,
right.
and things get better on your side of the street. Yeah. Like you said, my side of the street is clean, man.
A lot of people that barely get into recovery, they want to make amends like the second week of it. I mean, it's not gonna happen. No, you got to wait, dude. I mean, you wait 5 years sometimes until, because they're not going to accept the people that loved you during your craziness are not going to accept your amends until they're really for sure that you're not going back to that person that you were.
Yep.
And, you know, because they've seen, they remember you say, hey, that's it, I'm done. I ain't going to do it no more.
Every weekend.
I promise you, every weekend.
In 2 weeks, nomás una, y esto, I'm not going to fuck up like last time. And so we would start bullshitting ourselves because our obsession to get high was overwhelming, you know. And so then we go, we take that first bump,
and then it's the
phenomenon of craving, and you can't stop. And then it's over, and you screw up the whole freaking show, you know.
That it's like having a headache and trying to get rid of that headache with a hammer.
Yeah.
You know,
it's like putting your hand on a comal all the time, bro. You keep doing it. That's a quemar,
wey. No, this time I won't. This time I won't. Not this time.
And then I remember my sponsor said one time, bro, because he said, man, Rock, you can't be in bars, Rock. You know, being in a bar, an alcoholic being in a bar is like a diabetic being in a bakery, man. You know, like, I never thought of that. You're gonna end up eating a piece of bread. Dice, pinche, siendo un alcohólico en una cantina es como siendo un diabético en una panadería, carnal. Cállate la boca, te vas a chingar una empanada, una conga o algo. ¿Entiendes? Sooner or later, but either way, man, I'm really glad you guys are doing well. I'm really happy Fama Enterprises is back and Javier Galván y Grupo Fama is on track to, you know, start creating some music, start releasing some music, start recording some videos,
start getting busy again, man, and do the things that you've always loved to do. And then, you know, the way you're helping people, bro, you know, I commend you with that, man. And it's an amazing feeling, and it's very rewarding. And it takes a lot of work, man, and a lot of, you know, a lot of, you know, passion to do what you do, man. And, you know, I mean, it's just awesome. And to see that Israel's with you, man, that's freaking awesome too, bro. Yeah.
Yeah. And we got Francisco. He used to work as one of our pyro guys. He was doing the pyro. Now he plays the drums. He played drums for Fama for a while, and now he's back with us. We got Bobby on the guitar. He's been with us for about 10 years. He's played in my gospel band, and now he's playing again with Fama. He played with Fama for a while as well.
Mm-hmm.
No le pagaron y ni se fue. And we're just having a good time, man. And yeah. You know, the greatest thing, Rock, is really I love people, man. And I appreciate the fact that people called the radio station. They bought our CDs, they bought our cassettes, you know. They supported us. They were part of our fan club. Whatever level they were in, I appreciate that, because I truly believe that God connected us with these people for a reason. Connected me with you. Connected us all, even today. You know, I think God, I feel that God has a plan for every one of us. There's a scripture in the Bible that says, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future." And that's incredible, because just in that little scripture, that Jeremiah 29:11, it tells me that God is in control. And everything that happens in our life, it's not always bad. Like COVID was bad. There was people that died. But, you know, I finished a book. It's called Celebrating 35 Years of Fama Music and God Always Wins. That's the subtitle. And it's being published by Zulam Publishing out of Miami. It's a Christian organization. They own Salem Media Group. And during COVID, for 10 years since I retired, I wanted to finish this book.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been writing this book for 10 years. Pero nunca la decidía, bro. Mm-hmm. Nunca lo acabé. Pues pegó COVID in my house. My daughter got it. Then I got it. Then my wife got it. For 3.5 weeks, we were quarantined. And in those 3.5 weeks, I finished the book. Wow. I was able to finish this book. Right now, we're getting all the pictures. If you have old pictures of Fama and Rock, we'll put it in there, bro, with your permission. And it's a book that brings hope and encouragement to people. It talks about how we started, how my life was, my family and my brothers and things like that. But then it also talks about the night that I got saved, when se me apareció la muerte. And then I got saved, and I started serving God, and I got ordained as a minister. I tell people, I'm ordained, man. I can marry you, I can bury you. you choose, you know. But it talks about all those things, and then it talks about COVID. You know, how this pandemic was unexpected, something that we didn't ask for. We didn't expect it, but it really served its purpose in my life in different ways. And I praise God that He brought us through it. I don't know if you guys got it or not, or you know people who did. I mean, I'm sure you do. But I've done 53 funerals. And every one of those funerals, whether it was Zoom funerals or in-person funerals, every one of those funerals needed hope, encouragement, and they needed God. They needed for God to touch them and comfort them and bring strength to them, because some of those people were devastated. Young people, old people, in-between people, they were dying of COVID, you know? And at every point, people needed hope. And I feel that this book will bring hope to them. I believe that the Word of God is the greatest thing that they can get. And we're giving it to them in a book, not in a religious way. I'm not telling you, go to my church or te vas a ir al infierno. Mm-hmm. I'm not doing that, you know. What I'm doing is, hey, man, let me tell you about my story. And let me tell you what God did in my life. And the book, the subtitle, I love it because it says, God always wins. And you know what? God always wins. Mm-hmm. And I encourage people to get on the winning side. And that's what the book is about. And it should be released in June or July because of COVID. I just spoke with our publisher today, Sandy, and she's not sure if it would be June or July or even August because, you know, they're skeleton crews over there. But nonetheless, we get to spread the word of God. We get to in a way that shows God's love to people, mm-hmm. you know, and that's what I love.
Do you have a website? You guys have a website or something? What is it? So we can tell everybody.
It's JavierGalvan.com.
Okay.
And it even rhymes, JavierGalvan.com. Uh-huh. And then we also have the Facebook page.
Okay.
Javier Galvan, the official page.
But JavierGalvan.com, that's where you go and you can link onto the Facebook page. Yep. Link on,
all that.
So just do that, JavierGalvan.com.
and find out and keep up to date with Javier and get the notifications. And I really highly recommend you start a YouTube channel, bro.
Yeah, that's
and when you do, and we can share the link here with our show, and people can go out there and get some positive energy from you.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, we have these tools at our disposal.
I know, man.
I mean, you need to take advantage of them.
And, you know, it just seems that we get so busy. But, you know, my wife says one thing. I always tell her, I don't have time. She said, you make time. Exactly. I said, ay, pues, tírame la chancla.
Yeah.
That's another shirt. Tírame la chancla. Yeah.
You don't even have to, you know, upload something every day. You can do it once a week, twice a week, whenever you feel. And then if you do, you know, try to do it at the same time every week so people can, you know, people get accustomed. Yeah. And then they'll, man, I swear, I bet you your YouTube channel will grow so fast, dude. And you'll have so many people. You'll reach so many people from coast to coast and in other countries as well. We had people come in on our chat zone saying, no sé cómo llegué yo aquí, pero pues me lo encontré y me gusta mucho. And they asked her where she was from, the Dominican Republic.
Wow. Oh, wow.
And Spain and Brazil. I mean, there's people.
That's great.
Toronto.
Yeah.
Raymond Rose Toronto, is from Toronto. Canada.
Wow. And then I connected a phone to the board, and I said, hey, le conecté un teléfono, se llámenme al 641-3241. The first call was from San Francisco. The second one was from Florida, dude.
Wow, that's praise God.
Yeah, awesome, bro. Mm-hmm. So,
you know what it was, right? They saw you shaking your buttocks.
Yeah. he was seeing the video of the wrestler. Gosh. The wrestler. We were watching the video on big screen. Talan nalgonronas en el big screen. Del wrestler. Ramones. Yeah. Danny Ramones. Javier, muchas gracias.
Thank you,
Israel,
thank
man.
You, brother,
God
for
bless
having
you
us,
all.
Man.
Thank you for
thank
joining
you
me
so
tonight.
Much.
This has been an amazing show. Hashtag PVT. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, thank you so much to our sponsor, the Law Office of Carlos A. Garcia. If you're injured in a serious accident, arrested on serious charges, you need an attorney that'll fight for you in court, because serious cases require a serious lawyer. Call him at 956-584-1448, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Visit his website at thegarciafirm.com. He's board certified in criminal law by the Texas Board of Legal Specialization. Let's all say goodbye to the camera, guys.
Goodbye to the camera, guys.
JavierGalvan.com. Javier anda con los selfies allá.
I got you. Here we go, one more.
Órale. Dile adiós a todos en la cámara, Jaime. I mean, Javier.
Jaime, otra vez con Jaime.
Jaime. I'm Jaime and my brother's Javier.
Yes, Jaime.
I'm Jaime and my brother's Javier.
Are you
right?
Talking to yourself again?
Yeah, I'm talking to myself in the third person. Y'all have a good one.
God bless you.
All right,
we'll see you on Monday with Shelly Lattish.
If you've been injured in a serious accident or you've been arrested on some serious charges, you need an attorney that's going to fight for you. Carlos A. Garcia.
Obviously, if you're approached by a federal agency as it relates to an investigation, be it healthcare fraud, drug conspiracies, money laundering, bank fraud, any other federal crime, you want to remain silent. You want to talk to a lawyer who can give you real, honest advice.
Give them a call right away, 956-584-1448, because serious cases require a serious lawyer.
I'm Carlos A. Garcia, a criminal defense attorney in the Rio Grande Valley. I've been practicing criminal law for over 15 years. I'm board certified in criminal law, and I can help you with every problem you may have.
Board certified in criminal law, attorney Carlos A. Garcia.